thank you, and I would like to thank the organizers for organizing this summer school. It's great to see so many young people interested in group theory here in Bur. I will speak actually about isoperimetry and growth of groups. We'll be considering a finitely generated group G. S will denote a finite generating set. We'll usually assume that S is symmetric. And I recall that the growth function counts the number of elements of length at most L in the Wirth metric associated to S. In other words, counts the size of the balls in the calligraphs, in the calligraph of G. It's clear that the growth function is a submultiplicative. Because to write a Wirth of length n plus m, there is at most v of n possibilities for the first n letters, at most v of m possibilities for the next m letters. And in particular, the growth function of n plus 1 is not greater than the cardinality of S v of n. Since the function is submultiplicative, if we take log of the growth function, this is a subadditive function. So if we divide it by n, as it's the case for any subadditive function, there is a limit. It tends to some limit. There exists limit. Or equivalently, we can take nth power of v of n. And there exists a limit as n tends to infinity, and we denote this limit by the letter v. It's also clear the growth function is submultiplicative, so clearly the growth can't be more than exponential. And so we say that if v is greater than 1, then there is a lower bound which is exponential. We say in this case that g is of exponential growth. For example, as you probably all know, if you take a free group on, let's say, D generators with D at least 2, then this, so the calligraph is a regular tree. So then the cardinality of the sphere, first of all, we have at most 2D possibilities. For the first letter, v of n plus 1 minus v of n. So is at most clearly 2d. And then for each next letter, we have at most 2d minus 1 possibilities. So it's clear that a free group is of exponential growth. And since it's very easy to see, if you have a free subgroup, then the group also has exponential growth, because subgroup clearly gives an estimate for the growth of the group. In particular, I forgot to mention, so it's clear that if we change the generating set, the growth function can change, but its asymptotics clearly doesn't change. If we have a free subgroup, the growth is at least exponential. And there are really many, many very important classes of groups which do admit free subgroups, like, for example, Tietz alternative. Says that any linear group, unless it's virtually solvable, has a free subgroup. Actually, it's enough even to have a free subsemigroup, clearly, sorry, Mark. If you have some group G that admits a free sub-semigroup, then the growth is exponential. It's exponential.
In the limit of the limit that you can use, there's supposed to be a log on the right hand side.
No, just I prefer V notation for
No, I didn't mean the right hand side, I mean the middle. Like in the middle, like
just first I said that there exists limit if you take log and divide it by n, and or equivalently if you take nth root of v of n, there exists a limit. So sometimes, indeed, sometimes one denotes by v, the log, rather log of our v, but I prefer to denote this v, the nth root. So if you have a free subsemigroup, clearly these trees inside the group give you a lower bound, which is exponential. So in particular, it is well known that by result of Milner and Wolff, if the group is solvable, either it is virtually nilpotent, in this case the growth is polynomial, or it has a free subsemigroup, then the growth is clearly exponential. And once more, revising Tietz alternative, so unless the group is virtually nilpotent, the growth is exponential. So we say, so when I say the growth is polynomial, so if V of n is smaller than n to some power, then we say the growth is polynomial. And by polynomial growth theorem of Gromov, which is quite a deep result, so it can happen if and only if the group is virtually nilpotent. And in this case, we can say more, not only that they have an upper bound, but really up to a multiplicative constant V of n should be n to the d. But then we can say if V of n is neither polynomial or exponential, then we say the growth is intermediate. Then it's not so easy to construct some groups where the growth is intermediate. And today we want to have some first glance on the still mysterious and rich class of groups of intermediate growth. And first I would like to remind a conjecture, the gap conjecture. Due to Grigorchuk. That says that if V of n is not polynomial, then V of n is greater exp some constant square root of n for all n. Or if you change the constant, the same is to say for all sufficiently large n. There is a weaker form of this conjecture that asks for exp n to some alpha. Some positive alpha. And even this weaker form is very, very open. So some motivation for this conjecture formulated by Grigorchuk. Yes, first of all, groups of intermediate growth were found by Grigorchuk in the 80s. And this kind of estimate holds for all his examples. And there are some general results. If you, for some classes of groups, if G is residually nilpotent, then the result of Grigorchuk also in the 80s says this is true. Much more recent result of John Wilson, if G is residually solvable, then at least the weak form of the conjecture is true with V of n greater x, some constant n to the power 1 over 6, unless the growth is polynomial. There are some more general results in this direction, but very, very little is known unless we assume some additional properties like here on the group. So the only really very general result is due to Yehuda Shalom and Teres Stau, who show the following, that G for any finitely generated group G, if V of n is not polynomial, if then V of n is greater than n to the power log n to some power, where C is some small absolute constant. So this is Shalom and Tau.
If G is residually nilpotent implies true, do you mean that?
That the growth either polynomial or greater than constant square root of n.
Either polynomial or? Like both are possible.
Yes, certainly both are possible. For example, if G is really nilpotent, for example, if G is abelian, okay, it is clearly residually nilpotent, so it could be polynomial, but true in the sense the conjecture is true, either polynomial or greater than x square root of n. So now these general results, the only really general result we have, this result with n to the log n to some power. So you see, it's much weaker than what is asked. So instead of having x n to some alpha, what is the weak form of Grigorchuk's conjecture ask, we have x, constant log n. So instead of n to the alpha, we have some log n. So far. And before we discuss the groups of intermediate growth, I would like to recall some other definitions. And we will, apart from the growth function, there is one other function we would like to consider, namely the Fellner function. So first of all, I recall that a finitely generated G is a finitely generated group. G is amenable if the following holds. If for any epsilon greater than zero, there exists a finite subset V in G such that the size of its boundary is epsilon times smaller than its size. And here the size, here the boundary means the following. When we speak about the boundary, it's a discrete analog discrete notion of the boundary. So we look on the Kelly graph. We have some subset V, for example, like here. And the boundary is defined as points of V at distance 1 from the complement of V, so such that the distance A in the Biot metric associated to S from V to G minus V, the set V, is equal to 1. So, for example, here in this picture, this square lattice was supposed to be a Kelly graph of Z2. And here's our set V. This point is not the point of the boundary, it's a point of V, but at distance 1, we don't have points outside of V. But all these points, for example, are points of the boundary, because here at distance 1, you have always have something not in V. Here I gave the definition for finitely generated groups. The definition can be adapted for countable groups, but for us it's sufficient to know that first of all, this definition for finitely generated groups, it's not difficult to check. It doesn't change us if we change the generating set S. And then if you take a countable group is amenable if and only if any finitely generated subgroup is amenable. So we can use it as a general definition for countable groups. And there are many, many examples of groups which are amenable. There are many, many examples of groups which are not amenable. Sometimes it could be difficult even for a given group to understand whether it's amenable or not. So on Wednesday you will have lectures on Thompson groups, where it's a big challenge to understand whether it's amenable or not. And but we need one more definition. Where is the eraser?
It's under. I saw it under.
Thanks. We'll need the definition of the Fellner function.
There's a better one, I think.
Could be.
Yeah,
this last one, thanks. Given G and S, the Fellner function measures the best possible size of the sets with small boundaries. So the Fellner function of N is defined as minimum of the cardinality of V, where the minimum is taken over finite sets V such that the boundary of V divided by the size of the boundary of V divided by the size of V is smaller or equal than 1 divided by N. So we see the Fellner function is well defined if and only if the group is amenable. So evaluating the Fellner function means solving the isoperimetric problem in our group. So when we want to understand what is the Fellner function of some group, first of all, we want some upper bound. And though it could be tricky in some complicated groups where we don't even understand whether they're amenable or not, but in many groups, it's not so difficult to find some examples of the Fellner sets. The sets like this with the small boundary are called Fellner sets. But the main problem to understand the asymptotic of the Fellner function is to find the lower bound of this function, meaning to prove some isoperimetric inequality in our group. So in the exercise list, you will have the example that in the free group, we will ask you to find best possible constant for linear isoperimetric inequality in the free group. So free group can be can be shown to be non-amenable, and unless you know it already, so you will have it in an exercise. And one can find best possible, so in the free group, for example, the boundary is always greater than the cardinality of the set times some constant. So the main problem about Fermi function is the amenable case. We would like to understand the asymptotics of this function. And again, when in some groups we do understand it, in some groups it could be also a difficult problem to find the lower bound. Now, before we formulate some general open equation, so we would like to prove now the following result due to Coulon and Salov cost. That says that the Fellner function is always asymptotically larger than the Kroghoff function. When I say asymptotically larger, if one function is asymptotically larger than the other one, if f2 of n is smaller, some constant, f2, some constant here of n.
It's for any group?
Yeah, this is for any group. Let's say that, though it's not important, let's say so that it makes G is any finitely generated group. Yes, it's true also for this exact comment. Let's assume that J is infinite, though inequality makes sense for finite groups as well. So when I say greater or equal, in fact, I don't want to write it now, but there are explicit constants for this inequality that we will see right now in the proof, so which makes some sense even for finite groups, but our main interest are infinite groups indeed. Is there some way to get the middle one? Maybe not. No. So I would like to. Ah, thanks a lot. Ah, now I see. Thanks, great. So let us take some set V. So V is finite, is a finite subset in our group G. Let us assume that its boundary is small with respect to its size. So let us assume dV, the cardinality of dV divided by cardinality of V is not greater than 1 over n. And we want to show that V cannot be too small. We want to show that the size of V is, up to multiplicative constant in the argument, not smaller than the Kroghoff function of n. So first, we want to choose some ball which is of more or less the same size as V. Namely, let's look on the minimal possible n such that the growth function of n, that is the size of the ball of radius n, is greater or equal than 2 times the cardinality of V. Since we assume that our group is infinite, it's clear that V of n tends to infinity as n tends to infinity. Larger and larger balls obviously cover all our group. So whatever number we fix here, we can always find some ball which is larger, and we take minimal n with this property. Then since n is minimal, observe that Vgs of n is not greater than 2 cardinality of s cardinality of v. Because we had a remark that v of n plus 1 is not greater than cardinality of s multiplied by v of n. So if we would have something larger here, if not, right, then not only for n, this is true, this would be true for n minus 1 as well. So we have n with these two properties. Now we'll do the following thing. We will consider all possible points v in v, and we will draw a ball of radius n centered at v. So we will consider the balls centered at v of radius n for all v in v.
Excuse me.
Yes.
Are these the same n in the? So you said that the boundary of
this is the same n. Yes.
Less than equal to 1.
Yeah, sure. So this was the argument. So we have fixed really this n, minimal possible n with this property, and then we observe that using submultiplicativity, using the fact that v of n plus 1, as we stated already, is not greater than cardinality of s times v of n, right? This was just a particular case of submultiplicativity that I have mentioned already, right? If you would have here something larger than this, so if v of n would be larger than 2s cardinality of v, then using this we would claim that v of n minus 1 was also greater or equal to cardinality of v, and this is in contradiction with what we assumed with took a minimal possible n.
You define an n before. The n is defined by the boundary of v. So that's why.
Yes, it's not the same n. Thanks a lot. So this is m, let's say. So now we continue the proof. So in any point v of v, we draw a ball of this radius m. And we want to count total number of points which are outside of our set v, taking into account the multiplicity. So n the number of points in all these balls outside of V with multiplicities. In other words, so we take any point which is in some of these balls and outside our V, we count in how many balls this point, we have this point, and we take the sum of all over all points outside V of this number of points, And this is our total number of n outside V. And we want to find two possible ways to estimate n. So what we can say, on one hand, for any ball, on one hand, n is greater than cardinality of V, because we have so many choices just for the center of our balls. And in each V, so we have at least cardinality of our ball. So VGS of M minus cardinality of V. We have at least so many points outside of our set V. At most, cardinality of V could be inside, so all the rest is outside. And by our assumption, this is greater than cardinality of V, and this is greater than cardinality of V, so this is greater cardinality of V squared. On the other hand, we want to get an upper bound for our number capital N. We do the following thing. We consider our ball centered at identity for a moment of the same radius as all these balls we are considering here. So this is the ball. We want to take the points of this ball and join them by geodesics with the center of the ball. So we add and add geodesic like this, so we get some spanning tree, so we fix some spanning tree. In the ball of the radius we consider that joins points, paths are geodesics between some points x and identity between x and identity. So we fix some spanning tree like this, and we consider shifts of the same spanning tree for all vertices V. So we can consider then this was a spanning tree, so let's denote it by gamma. And we want to shift it to have it in all points, so for all V we consider V times gamma. So then we will have the same, basically the same tree everywhere for our balls. And now take some point which is outside. So we have some point, let's say y here. Look on this geodesic path inside gamma between y and v. We look on the path between y and v. And look what happens. Y is outside our set V. This small v is inside our set V. Meaning, and this is a geodesic path. Then clearly, this path intersects at least once the boundary of V. Right? So here there is the boundary. We take some x, consider if there are several, let's say, closest to y, x on the boundary of V and on this path, x on the path between y and V. Now observe, even if you wouldn't know our center, we can fix the following information. So I keep the gap conjecture.
But there are some sideboards if you like.
Yes. And there is more than one?
Yeah.
Ah, great. Very good. So again, we have some ball. Here's, there is the center V. Here's somewhere the boundary of our set V. Here we had some point Y in some geodesic path intersecting the boundary. Suppose we would know V minus 1 times Y, meaning we know this quotient, we know what is the role of Y inside our ball. And suppose we would know also the distance, we know y, v minus y, v minus 1 times y, to know this element. And if we would, no, how to say it. And suppose we know this distance between y and x. Suppose no, this element only and this distance. Then I want to say that we can figure out where is the center of the ball if we know this distance. If we know x. We know this point. We know this distance, and we know this element. Then we can figure out where the center was. Meaning that if we can say that our cardinality n then is at most the following thing. So we have at most V of M possibilities of for this element V minus 1 Y, just possibilities, what is this element in the ball. We have at most M elements for M possible choices for the distance. Since this is a ball of radius m, so this distance is not more than m. Times m. And we have all possible choices on the boundary of V. And so we multiply by the size of our boundary V. Here there are only two or three. Okay. So what have we got? This we can maybe delete. Where was the other inequality? Ah, it was there. So on one hand, n is smaller what we have written here. So on one hand, n is smaller than V of M, and V of M, we knew that V of M is at most, so this was at most two cardinalities of S, which is just some constant, cardinality of V, and then we have M, and cardinality of dV. So on one hand, our capital N is smaller, some constant, which is 2 times cardinality of S, cardinality of V, multiplied by m and cardinality of dv. And on the other hand, n was larger than cardinality of v squared. And so we received what we want. So we just divide by cardinality of v. We obtain that dv, cardinality of dv divided by cardinality of v, is greater or equal than what do we take the v is some constant, which is 1 divided by 2 times cardinality of S, some constant divided by M. So if the size of M, of V was approximately V of M, this was our assumption at the beginning of the proof, then we concluded that the boundary should be greater than this. So we have proved what we need to prove in Kolon-Salov-Coster inequality. Let's have a look on some examples. And let's take a look when this inequality is asymptotically sharp. Just some general remark. What kind of examples of amenable groups we know? So if you have ZD, for example, as Z2, actually we have drawn already the picture. If we take some ZD, if we take some cube and of the size n to the d, its boundary, so this is V is a cube, V is a cube. Its boundary is, so the cardinality of V is equal to this, and the boundary is some constant times, approximately some constant times n to the d minus 1. Right? For example, on the squares here, the cardinality of the square is n square, and the cardinality is of the perimeter is something like 4n or 4n plus 1. Right. So very easy to see in abelian groups, there are sets, simply cubes like this, with the boundary much smaller than these sets. And instead of considering the cubes like this, we could consider simply the balls. Alternatively, we could consider the balls of radius n in our abelian group. And then also easy to see. We have the same thing, so the cardinality of the ball is n to the d, and the size of the boundary, that is the size of the sphere, bn, is approximately n to d minus 1. And more generally, if we simply know that the Grove bound, more generally, another example. If you would assume that V of n is smaller than some constant n to the d, it's clear that there exists a subsequence such that Vn plus 1 minus V of n is smaller some constant n to d minus 1. If such sequence doesn't exist, we would multiply, then if you consider Vn plus 1 divided by V of n, we would multiply each times by 1 plus 1 over n, and we would get a contradiction. So just elementary observation, just using the Grove, we see that the balls are nice Zollner sets, at least for a subsequence. It's a little bit less, it's less straightforward to use only the Grove, but after all, since we know that the group of polynomial Grove are virtually nilpotent, the same true not only for subsequence, the same is actually true for all n. So the balls are asymptotically optimal Zollner sets, so because we know the general lower bound is Kolon-Salov-Coster, and just looking on the observation that the spheres are much smaller than the balls in nilpotent groups, we see that Kolon-Salov-Coster inequality is asymptotically optimal for all groups of polynomial Grove. Now, what happens for groups of exponential Grove? for groups of exponential growth, for some groups, the inequality is still optimal, and for some others, it could be very far from being optimal. But let's have a look on some optimal example. I recall that a leaf product of two groups, A and B, is an extension of the sum of copies of B and indexed by A. So we take just a direct sum of B's. And A acts on this direct sum just by shifts on the index set. We take the extension. This is called a leaf product. I prefer an old-styled Ukrainian notation. For me, it's group A that acts. So there are two possible notations for leaf products. Sometimes this group is denoted by A leaf product B, and sometimes B leaf product of A. I should take care reading the papers. But anyway, this is an extension of two groups like this. This is called leaf product. So some very basic and well-known examples is something that called lamplighter group. Group is when our group, let A could be, for example, Z, but what is important, our group B has two elements. B is a finite group consisting of two elements. The corresponding leaf product, so A with B, is called lamplighter group. Why? Because it's easy to visualize the elements of this leaf product, and also it's easy to visualize the Wirth metric for this leaf product. Why this group is called lamplighter? We can imagine the following thing. We have Z, or some other base group for us, Z for a moment. And suppose that in each point of Z, we have some lamp. So on. What happens with our Wirth metric? So we have two generators. One generator is generator of Z. So elements of our groups will be pairs. Some Z and Z, and F, by definition here, F is some element here. If we can interpret this F as a function from Z to Z to Z, and it's a finitely supported function, finitely supported. How we view this element? So we say Z, well, Z is some element in Z. And this function, we look on its support. If some element is in the support, we say the lamp is on in this point. And if it's not in the support, we say the lamp is off. What happens with the Wirth metric? So there are two generators in our leaf product. One is generator of Z. If you multiply it, we just take a step on Z without changing configuration at all. And the other generator is the lamp generator, meaning we don't work on Z. We just change the lamp where we stand. All the other lamps are left as they will. So this is the lamplighter group. So let's see that Kolontsalev-Costa inequality is asymptotically sharp for this lamplighter group. Why? Say Kolontsalev-Costa bound is sharp, is asymptotically sharp. For Z leaf product Z to Z or with any other finite group. Consider, so we fix some N. Consider an interval, let's say from minus N to N in Z. This is some optimal Fermi set in Z, right? And so we say Z is this interval minus nn, and say that the support of F is also belongs to the same interval. Then the cardinality of, what is the cardinality of this set we consider? So the cardinality is our set V is 2 to the power 2n plus 1, because there are so many possibility for lambs. We consider 2n plus 1 points in each, the lamb can be on and off, gives us 2 to the power 2n plus 1, and there are 2n plus 1 possibilities for our point Z. So we have some sets growing exponentially. And one can observe that cardinality of V divided by cardinality of the boundary divided by cardinality of V is not more than 1 over n. Why? Just consider all possible choices of our configuration. Having this choice, we have 2n plus 1 possibilities. Oh, let's say it's 2, I don't know, is it 1? Precisely, it's 2 divided by 2n plus 1. So for each possible, for each fixed configuration, we have 2n plus 1 possibilities for our point Z, and only for the endpoints of the corresponding interval, the point will be on the boundary of our set. So among, for each fixed generator, there are 2 points among 2n plus 1, which are on the boundary. So we see, we see the Fellner function is at most exponential by this easy example, and by Coulomb-Salov-Constant inequality, we know it couldn't be smaller than exponential. So it is optimal. There are many other groups where the inequality is optical. For example, for any polycyclic groups, for those who know this definition, it is optimal, or for groups of finite proof rank, for example. But there are many examples, and not difficult examples, where the inequality is far from being optimal. We will discuss maybe in a moment what are known results in this direction. But now I would like to formulate one more conjecture, and which is more recent. So gap conjecture for growth is one of the famous open questions in geometric group theory. And there is a more recent conjecture, this time due to also due to Grigorchuk, but together with Pansiun. Which says the following: for any, let's say, infinite finitely generated group G, either the Fellner function is polynomial, or the Fellner function is at least exponential, greater than x some constant n. If this conjecture would be true, it shows that for intermediate growth groups, Coulomb-Salov-Coste is never optimal. We'll, in the next lecture today, we will discuss the first example of groups of intermediate growth, the first Grigorchuk group, and for this group, the growth is approximately x n to some alpha, with alpha smaller than 1. And so Coulomb-Salov-Coste just gives us this lower bound x n to the alpha, but conjecturally, it can be always improved. And this conjecture, obviously, also very far from being solved. And in remaining, how many minutes? I have 3 minutes or something? 5 minutes? Okay. Just some more general words about isoperimetry of in the intermediate growth case. Yes, general remark. So in the gap conjecture that I just erased for the growth functions, there is this lower bound x n to the alpha, and it's not clear at all what are best possible alpha to conjecture. Well, maybe 1/2 if you believe in a strong form, but it's not a priori, it's not clear at all what is really the minimal possible bound. What is interesting in the gap conjecture for isoperimetry, though it's a bit less known maybe than the general gap conjecture for growth, that if true, it's clearly optimal. These easy examples, which we have just seen, there are groups of exponential growth, the Fermi function is exponential. So you can't certainly can't ask nothing larger than exponential, and the conjecture asks, this is always the case. Just some obvious remark that I have not done, that if growth is sub-exponential, of is sub-exponential, then the group is amenable. Growth of G exponential, then G is amenable. Again, so I explained before for polynomial growth case, but again, there is, the proof is that subsequence for subsequence sequence of possible radii and I, the boundary of the ball of radius and I should go, if you divide by cardinality of the ball, this should go to zero. Because if not, if there is some positive constant as a lower bound, then we would get that Vf for all n, or for all sufficiently large n, let's say, V of n plus 1 would be greater than Vn times 1 plus c for all sufficiently large n. Then we would get that V of n is greater 1 plus c n minus some constant, so n exponential. So it's clear if the growth is exponential, some bolts are Fellner sets. But in contrast with the polynomial growth case we discussed, there is no reason to believe that the Fellner sets we get are optimal. Right? So in polynomial growth case, they are really n times smaller. The size of the boundary of the ball of radius n was n times smaller. Here, the only thing we can claim in general, the ratio should go to zero.
There is boundary sign missing. The ratio of the boundary, thank you, of the ball could not be constant times the cardinality of the ball. Because otherwise, each time we would multiply the growth function by some constant greater than one.
Maybe I have so 2 minutes left, right, to give quickly to start giving the definition of the Grigorchuk group that we will discuss in the next lecture. Because if you look on the exercise list, all exercises but the last one, you know already all the definitions, so you can try to solve them. There is one marked with star on one hand because it is more complicated than the other exercises, and on the other hand that I was not sure I have time to give the definition of the Grigorchuk group, so maybe it's an exercise rather for not for this problem session, but one exercise left for the future for you. But I just very, very briefly sketch the definition of the first Grigorchuk group, but I will really explain it after the break in the second lecture. Ah, there is one here, thank you. We will consider a rooted binary tree, like this. We will consider four automorphisms of this rooted boundary tree. We'll have A, which interchanges the large branches of this tree. and doesn't do anything else. This will be our generator A. And then there will be generators B, C, D. And their action on this tree would be defined recursively. So, for example, this element B. We say first, on the first level, it doesn't move big branches. The first branch will go to the first branch, and the second will go to the second. And on this first branch, actually, it will act like A. This notation we use means that we identify this subtree with a large tree, and A meaning interchanging the branches of this next level. And on this point, we'll say it acts like C. What does it mean, X like C? C we have not designed yet, but we say if we identify this branch with the whole tree, the action of B should be the same as the action of C. And then for the C, we write a similar thing. C does not change also the big branches, but acts as A, interchanging the branches of next level on the first branch, and acts like D here. And D is slightly different because it's acts trivially on the first branch, so also the branches are preserved acts trivially on the first branch, and acts as B on the second branch. So I have to finish this definition here. This definition, if you have not seen it, takes some time to understand good, right? So I will try to explain you in more detail in the next lecture, but at least I started formally. I gave you the definition of the first Grigorchuk group that you see in the last exercise, in the exercise list.